it's a lot of fun for me to get to do this way and to get people together and to sit around and talk about what we do, talk about what we like, talk about who we are, and we get to share that back out to these guys. We all know each other. You guys know each other?
Mm-hmm. You met at a...
Everybody knows each other.
Yep.
So why don't we just do a quick once around.
My name's Phil Ivanusic-Vallee. I'm the creator of cartoon TV shows. League of Super Evil, Oh No, It's an Alien Invasion, and Freakdown. And mostly a writer. That's my speciality, I suppose.
Excellent. This fellow over here. Oh yeah, we're going to do that.
And you're in development with a show called Dinosaurs.
Oh, right. It's all right. Yeah. Well, I don't know if we're allowed to say. And we have a show together.
Plug.
We'll plug. Yeah. Oh, we'll get to that. Yeah.
Yeah. For anyone looking to buy one.
Yeah.
My name is Mike Geiger. I'm also a creator of TV shows. I don't know.
Name any of them?
Winston Steinberger and Dudley Ding Dong. That's the only one that's out.
And this fellow to my right.
I'm Dave Cooper. I was a underground cartoonist and a painter, and then recently I became a creator of two TV shows. One is Nickelodeon's Pig Goat Banana Cricket, and the other one is Teletoon's The Bagel and Becky Show.
Cool. Now we're going to try to get around to things like character development. We're going to get around to things like, you know, what we're doing. But what I'm finding is kind of working, and we're getting a little more interesting stuff out of people, is getting into sort of how we got here.
Oh,
how you got here. Like, awesome. But beyond that, the simpler the better. Like, what kind of kid were you? Let's start right here. What kind of kid were you?
Very quiet, introspective, low confidence. It's kind of a bummer to think about it. I enjoyed it. I felt like I enjoyed it at the time, but in retrospect, I think I was spending a lot of time by myself with my own thoughts, sort of like hiding from the rest of the world. I think that's how I was able to sort of go into my own imagination and just sort of like create or imagine worlds. I remember like lying on the forest floor for long stretches and just like staring at moss and just imagining that it's this little alien landscape, and just, you know, I feel like I was trying to get away from everything else. And that's kind of what my career is turned out to be, is like, you know, a larger version of that.
Of moss.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm still...
You're drawing moss.
I'm still Googling, like, moss and lichen, and oh, fuck, it's just, you know, so amazing.
Now, you're from out east, right?
Yeah, I'm from Nova Scotia.
And big family, small family?
I had three siblings.
Yeah? Where are you in that?
I'm the baby.
You're the baby?
Mm-hmm.
What did you have, like, was it a creative home? Were you guys... Was
very creative, yeah. My dad was a doctor and a carpenter and machinist. He built boats. Like, he built many, many boats. I think the last boat he built was about his 15th or 16th, which was a yacht that they retired in and sailed all the way to Central America in, and bought land in Honduras and built a house. And, you know, there's like very, very... they have a lot of... They're very capable.
Yeah.
My mom was creative. She was like, she baked and cooked and drew. My uncle was a jazz clarinet player.
So there were arts related careers in mm-hmm. your extended world.
Yeah. Yeah, I think the biggest influence from those days was the children's book author Tommy Ungerer was a friend of my parents. So at a very young age, he would come and visit, and I would see this example of someone who's making a career out of drawing.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I feel like a lot of kids don't get that, and they just sort of see it as a very abstract thing that's not attainable. So I think that was a big influence on.
Because it is, I think it's interesting. So when you came to animation a little later on, we at least have all kind of, we came up through studios, a lot of that kind of environment, animation studios. You're more of a writer.
Yeah, well, studied animation in university, but yeah.
Did you really?
Yeah, I'm actually an animator.
So you were a drawer originally?
I was, and I just became not. I just stopped. And
Okay.
It's weird.
So, because it's interesting, like, you get this community of all these people in these different studios all working, you know, and so you get a variety of human beings, right, with different personality types, but it's, there's a common thread of, at some point, everybody in that room, at least on the drawing side, rather than go outside and play ball, rather than go and do whatever as a kid, it was that choosing this very solitary hobby, this very solitary interest. The relationship between here and a piece of paper is something that you do. And I had a cousin I drew with, but it's what you do alone. And it's something that kind of, I think, it binds everybody in that room. And it's always interesting for me to find out sort of, so I know guys who kind of came back to it later, or started out, because we all draw as babies, as kids, as little kids, and then people, it's really not when people stop drawing, it's when people don't stop. Mm-hmm. So it's always kind of interesting to see why did you keep doing it instead of somebody else? Like, why didn't you stop? You know, those kinds of things.
Yeah, for me, it was the only thing that made me feel like I was good at something. It sort of centered me. Like, I would feel anxious if I didn't.
Yeah.
It was, you know, I was in this family of very capable, clever people, and I just didn't feel like I was one of them in a way, you know?
Really?
I just always felt like I was missing something or not, you know, things were sort of going over my head. But if I could just go off on my own and draw it, it was like, I just felt good.
And did you get, like, can you pinpoint a moment of affirmation? Because that's another thing that I think I can, I know for myself, I can remember a drawing I did. I know I've heard a lot from other people said there was this one time, and it was, yeah. Or these three things where, like, grandma on the fridge, you know, like my drawing on the fridge at grandma's house, this and that. Did you have a moment of reinforcement?
I did, yeah. It was, I had drawn this picture of some guy, like maybe a medieval warrior or something. But, like, I you know, when you're a kid, you always draw characters. And they're just standing, you know, stiff. I did this one drawing for the first time ever where there was like maybe some foreshortening. And it was like a little bit dynamic. And I showed it to my dad and he flipped. And
how old were you?
Oh, like 12, 13. And, you know, it's just one of those moments that, like, in real time, it just drifts by and you're like, okay, let's have dinner now. But it sticks with you and it becomes like this thing that you, you're always chasing, you know, you want that kind of affirmation.
Yeah.
Whether it's for someone else or for yourself.
So what about you guys? What kind of kid were you?
To be honest, like I'm kind of the exact opposite. Like I didn't draw until really late. I was a skateboard kid, you know, so I was all into skateboarding for my, you know, childhood, I guess, past my childhood. And then once that ended, I was sort of like, that's when I started to get into drawing. Like I was a terrible artist. Well, you know. Anyway, I think I applied to like Emily Carr. I remember after all that, and they said no. Like you're too terrible. And so, like I think.
Was that their wording?
Well, no, I don't know about that. But you know, it was just like it was super late, and I couldn't get into art school, and I it was sort of the next thing to go for, you know. But I mean, I went to Vancouver Film School. And that program's 12 months long. And so you can't learn to draw in 12 months, you know? So like, when I went into the industry, I couldn't draw anything, you know? And it was just something that I was kind of forced to learn over time. And I guess I've been in the industry long enough that I can hold my ground now, but it was definitely like a super, super late start for me.
So as a non-drawer, you applied to Vancouver Film School with what kind of portfolio? How did you get in?
Well, you know, I did some, they were horrible. Like, they were right not to accept me. But like being a skateboarder for all that time, I had like a heavy influence from skateboard culture, which is based in artwork, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like graphics and all, like the ads and everything are very art-centric. So it's not like I didn't understand what looked good, I think. But like I had some sense of design, but I just didn't practice it. Did I answer your question? I feel like I went crooked.
How did you get into the industry without like chops that are as strong as they are today?
There was like a 2-month intensive course at Capilano College where you could like introduction to animation. And so doing that, I at least had like the bouncing ball I could show Vancouver Film School to get in with. But I mean, I don't think a prerequisite of getting into Vancouver Film School is, you know, being a good artist. I think it's more like, can we make an animator out of this person? And nowadays, it's not necessary that you know how to draw to animate, right? So it's a sort of different credentials, but.
So what year was that?
I graduated the film school in 1999.
So things were 2000. Going digital.
Yeah, I was just right at the turn. In fact, it's funny because when I first applied at Capilano College for that, they're like, hey, what do you want to do, 2D or 3D? And 3D, this 3D Max program just came out and it was like super fresh. And it was like the very beginning of 3D. And I'm like, oh, I want to draw, you know? But like in hindsight, like, man, like, I could have got in on the ground floor, you know? But, you know, whatever. It worked out okay in the end.
So what was the first job?
My first job was at I couldn't get a job because, like, you know, skills aside, you know, I was in Vancouver, and the only studio that really was working in Vancouver at the time was AKA. They were making Ed, Edd n Eddy, and they were storyboarding for Ed, Edd n Eddy. And obviously, to storyboard for a Cartoon Network show, you have to have some pretty good chops, as you say. And so I ended up getting a job at an internet company making like e-cards in Flash. And again, it was like, this was before Flash 4. It wasn't even called Flash at the time. I don't even remember what it was called. But it was like the very, very start of Flash, which again, probably like helped me in the long run because like, you know, I still use Flash to this day.
Well, yeah, you really built, like, your look is sort of an expansion from you're a vector artist.
Yeah, I guess so.
In a lot of ways,
yeah.
You're very Flash centric. You can do a lot with it. You do a lot with Flash.
Yeah, and like
you're of that result, but you're of that type. You come at it with a lot of strong use of the strength of Flash.
Yeah, I think it saved me from not being able to draw, you know? Like I could do a graphic style that you didn't necessarily have to understand, you know, bone structure to do a Flash web series, you know? So I think that really saved me. It still saves me.
Obviously. But you've also got a really strong sense of cartoon. Like your stuff, people glom on it very quickly with things like UPA references and Hanna-Barbera references and that kind of flat, cool cartoon thing. Yeah. Like where's, you came from this sort of skateboard culture, which I'm gonna guess you probably drew a lot of big feet. And sort of swooping,
baggy pants,
swoopy things.
No, I wasn't in. I wasn't into that. But
where did the cartoon thing come from? Where did that?
To be honest, and this is going to sound super cheesy, but I think it came from skateboarding. Like, if you watch,
Von Bode?
Sorry,
was Von Bode like kind of a big skateboard artist?
I don't know who that is.
Oh, you don't?
No.
I mean, he was pre-skateboard, but I think some skateboarders really dig his work.
I'm not familiar. You have to give me a link.
Oh, well,
you look it up. I think it comes from skateboarding. Like, just timing in skateboarding is really important. You know, if you have a good, you know, say style in skateboarding, it's based on timing, you know? And on that same note is like skateboard videos were incredibly popular when I was growing up. I was super into them. And sort of same thing, like you know, editing timing and that sort of thing was super important. You know, it was like one of the few things that were edited to song beats, you know, really tight in every skateboard video. So when we would do our skateboard videos, of course, we would be really aware of like, you know, where are we going to hit this song? Where are we going to do this? And I think that really, really translated into animation.
That's interesting because it is, you make a lot of little short cartoons over the course of your career. You have a fair bit of output that way.
Yeah, I used to, yeah.
Yeah. And it's interesting to see because they're very simple.
Yeah.
There are there's not a lot of animation, but it's the timing.
Yeah.
You know when to use it.
Yeah, I'll also say, like, give credit to Bob Jakes, too. You know, like, one of my first jobs was an animator on the Ren and Stimpy show, and Bob was doing timing on that, and, like, he's the king of timing, you know? And so, yeah, I learned a lot from Bob and just how he works. He was, like, super gracious in showing us everything, you know? So I think that was really important.
Seems that everybody that's touched a Ren and Stimpy show seems to have walked away with some kind of education.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I remember, I was never a strong artist. So going into that, you know, I was scared. And I remember, like, we had to clean up our keys. And I was like, oh my God, like, are you kidding me? Like, I don't know how to clean up a drawing. So I went and I got, like, I had a pencil I got at, like, Halloween once or something. It had, like, ghosts on it. So I'm like, oh, perfect pencil to clean up drawings. Of course, it was horrible. Anyway, I cleaned it up and I handed it all in. And Bob's like, cool, you can clean them up now. Like, he wasn't being a jerk. He just didn't know. He thought it was a rough. And I'm like, dang. But, like, that's just what you need to learn, you know?
School of hard knocks.
Yeah.
What about you, sir?
As a kid?
Yeah.
I don't think I was that sort of introspective or shy, but I did draw a lot. I mean, that's kind of, like listening to you guys talk about it, I kind of realized, like, yeah, man, I used to draw all the time. But I would always be more like on the, like making like comic books and stuff. And I think one of the first sort of like, yeah, comic books that I ever did or storybooks that I did, like I did it for my grandma. And I tried to sell it to her for $70 so I could buy a Nintendo. And I was like, this probably worked.
Right? Yeah.
How old are you trying to?
I was pretty young. I think it was 6 or 7 or 7.
Trying to fleece your grandma? Just,
yeah, whenever Nintendo came out. So yeah, it was. But then she's like, oh, it's nice. How about I give you $2? And I was like, okay. And she still has it. It's like the $70 is written in the top corner of the thing, and it's crossed out, and like $2 is written under it. For a dollar, I don't remember how much I got for it. So it was good bargaining. You know?
Was that some affirmation for you? Did you have
that kind of
a moment?
I was lucky because I was surrounded. Like all my grandparents and parents and stuff were always like really supportive of drawing and stuff. It was never like stop drawing because, like it was I would do it and you know it's like looking back at it, just looking at through some of the cause obviously my grandparents and my parents kept all the scrapbook stuff and I look back at it, I'm like, well this is actually pretty good. So yeah, there's a lot of that. And then we with my cousins and my sister and stuff, we put on like plays and stuff. So I was very much like the shooting little videos in the basement and stuff. So it wasn't just drawing. I think it was a lot of like that storytelling stuff that I think I really, really liked. And I think drawing was a way to tell stories. So whenever I draw, it's always like story-based. So whether it was like drawing Mario levels or Mega Man levels I used to do. So it was always kind of like based around story. So
clearly like creatively nurturing environments.
Oh yeah, yeah, for sure. Like everyone was like
Was there anybody around you that had like a job in?
No, I don't think you could do it. Like it was like there was always like.
You're from Montreal.
I'm from Montreal. Yeah. So my family was always like, just, you know, like mom's a nurse, dad works at an engineering company and stuff. So like you know like jobs. I think there might have been like one cousin of the cousin or something that was like the actor or the actress, but like you know that never really like it wasn't like it wasn't like the beacon of it. It was like that you know oh that one's an artist, but like you can't sort of support yourself as that. So for me it was always like I wasn't gonna go to school and. In the arts, I was going to go be a marine biologist or paleontologist or something like that. So.
I mean, my mom wanted a dentist.
Bad teeth.
My brother had the braces. So this past week for me was kind of a big week, picking up to see a Canadian Screen Award.
Yeah.
I brought
yeah.
it home yeah, for my parents this week, and like my parents are busting. This thing is sort of like. I have very complicated feelings about this award, but them, it's like, this is real.
This is your stamp.
Yeah. Like 25 years of this, but this is real. And it's like, it makes sense to them. And they've always been supportive, but like underneath it all, my mom would have liked a dentist.
It's
what would, like, do you have any, that, like parents have a dream for you that wasn't this?
I don't know.
Are they just glad you have a job?
Yeah, actually, my dad is very pleased that it kind of like worked out. Because like I remember when I applied for university, I said I was going to it was in Cégep, so Cégep, I was going to go do the arts and letters program. And then my dad's like, oh, that's nice, but you might want to maybe take some marketing classes on the side. And even like when I went to university at Concordia in animation, I did the 3-year sort of film school animation program. I still ended up taking like electives. My electives, instead of taking like more painting classes and stuff, like a lot of my classmates, I ended up taking marketing and advertising, and I hated it. But like it was kind of like my dad's voice in the back of my head going like, just safety, just be place safe, just have a backup just in case. And I think I tend to play with like that safety net mentality a lot in the stuff I do. So it was always there just in case if being an artist, because there was no sort of person in my immediate family that I can look up to. Be like, oh, this is how you get a career in the arts. So a lot of the positive affirmation career-wise came from teachers at Cégep and teachers in university that were like, no, you can get a sort of a career doing this. And then that was it, so.
When did the writing switch? When did that happen?
It happened when I did my whole university degree was animation, so making short films. Back then, like it was in sort of mid 2004 or something. And we were still shooting some stuff on Bolexes and on Oxburys.
I went to Concordia.
Steinbeck. So we're still like very like film school.
Yeah.
And I was more like I want to do cartoons and say kind of stupid stuff. Yeah, okay, yeah, so you know the pain. We'll talk like
1 year. I did 1 year.
We did the full 3.
Goes gone.
But that was my thing. I always wanted to, like, you know, and even in high school, I was like, I want to have my own TV show. I want to have a TV show on The Zone. That was like my high school.
What was The Zone? Was that YTV?
Yeah, it's YTV. Yeah.
Phil.
It was PG Fresh Phil. Yeah, at the time, I was like, I want to, like, my cartoon on The Zone. That was the dream. But yeah, I guess so somewhere along the way, like in university, I kind of, you know, realized that to get a job afterwards, like I was good. Like I had a decent set of skills, but I don't think I had the patience to be as awesome as I think some people that are like true born artists. And I was always more leaning towards the storytelling. So I ended up partnering up with Peter Rick, who's the co-creator of League of Super Evil and director on the feature that we just shot in November. So we've been working together for like 10 years, but he was like, just like the kid in the class that was like the like really good, like the best. So, yeah. So when the time came to League of Super Evil, my first series was essentially my thesis film in university. And like after it was done, I wrote it with a buddy of mine, David LeBlanc, who's another writer. So we were like, well, let's make it into a show. But I'm like, I don't want to like draw it, like, because writing will take a big chunk of it. So then we just approached Pete and said, like, Pete, do you want to be like the artist on this? And then he said, yeah, so then we started partnering up. So it was just like almost like a realizing that making a show was a lot of work. And that I was probably, my strengths lean towards the storytelling writing side. Like I was better at that than I was at drawing. So it made sense to be like, well, Pete, you're way better at me than at drawing. So just, you know, he's a machine for that. So I think it's a partnership thing. And I think that, like, because that's what you want to say once you get out there. Like doing your own short films is one thing, but I think once you get into the business, it's labor intensive, right? Like you don't draw your entire show, or you just find the thing that you can best help the show. And for me, it was right with knowledge of animation, with knowledge of storyboarding, with knowledge of the art stuff. But I'm not gonna like go and say like no, like Mike, like on dinosaur stuff, like no, Mike, this is how you should draw it. like because you're way better at it, so. So that was the switch. So it was
so collaboration early on. So it's interesting. So for you guys, both of you, now you came up more in the animation. I mean, animation as a TV animation is a collaborative thing. It's all, everyone's a piece of a larger assembly line. But you often made a lot of your own stuff for a very long time, and that's a very, you have a lot of control. You make things yourself, you finish them, they're done, they're out there as you made them. You, it's comics, same experience. Mm-hmm. You make something, you control it. You know? What? Adjusting into a TV show.
Insane.
Yeah.
Yeah, so weird. Because, you know, getting into animation was a dream for 10 years. You know, I would push and push and push. Just feel like I have to do this. You know, somehow I'm going to take, you know, my skills in comic books and translate them into animation.
Because you had a lot of tiny starts along the way.
Yeah.
You had a Cartoon Network little flash cartoon for, like, when they did those things, like one-offs. It was also a multi-animal.
Yeah, I forget what it was called. It was called Bird Bug Goat.
Yeah.
And then the music video for Danko. But the whole time, I really didn't know what I was getting into. Like, I just, like, I have to be a TV creator, you know? And then when it happens, it's like, holy crap, man. This is a whole other planet.
When you had an early experience with Futurama.
Right, but that was really almost the equivalent of like an illustration.
Like you just did a bunch of drawings for
it. I was in my house in Ottawa, and they'd send me assignments and I'd send stuff back, so I didn't feel like I was in animation. And in fact, at that point, I didn't want to be in animation. People would always say to me, wow, you know, your drawings look like they should be animated. And I'd be like, yeah, I don't want, you know, I just want to be like an individual artist and, you know, like create everything and have total control. But at some point, I guess it was after I did the Danko Jones video, it was such a positive experience, and I was so happy with the results. I was like, okay, maybe everybody's right. Like, I should do animation.
Well, you did get to work with Nick Cross. Yeah. You know, it's not like you're working with a...
Well, I mean, that's a good point.
You're a good partner.
Because that kind of underlines that other people, like, you know, the whole team, you know, you partner with somebody who's amazing, and your project's going to be fantastic, right? What was the question?
So you have two shows now. Which one went first? You guys did the Nickelodeon short first.
Yeah. Well, actually, those two projects happened almost concurrently from day one, which is kind of weird. Like, I got calls from Nickelodeon and Radical Sheep within like weeks of each other, you know, saying, would you like to try to do something? And they both took 7 years to, you know, the point where we actually greenlit the show.
Yeah.
I think maybe Bagel was like a year later or something. But
getting thrown into, let's talk about the Nickelodeon one then, because you commuted, you went back, you worked in studio there, mm-hmm. and you had to, and it was a, it started as one, as a short, so they approached you to do something.
Yeah.
And was it a pre-existing property? Was it anything you'd come up with before?
Audrey called me and just said, hey, do you want to pitch something to Nick? And I was like, yeah, that sounds great. So I originally wanted to pitch Bagel, and they said, well, we wanted to create something brand new that we could co-own together. Yeah. So it had to be something totally fresh. And I wanted to get Johnny Ryan involved as my co-creator because I hate my own writing. Like, I don't.
So you immediately wanted someone working with you.
Within the realm of television, I do not enjoy writing. Outside of television, it's like this kind of, like, I love the quirkiness of my writing and how it's not very polished and it's not, doesn't have any, you know, like the proper structure. But within television, I'm like, okay, we need a professional, you know? So I got Johnny attached. And
I think it's funny that your professional is Johnny Ryan.
And we came up with a bunch of different ideas and pitched them, and it was sort of lukewarm, and then Johnny was like, you know, we did this comic strip, two-page comic strip for Nickelodeon magazine like a few years prior. So we just sent her a JPEG of that, and she was like, well, this looks like something we could work on. It was pig, banana, robot. So obviously, like, through like years of
robot got splintered.
I'm always trying to put robots in shows.
Yeah.
I think every show's better with a robot.
Yeah, I mean, it's just that cricket whole television thing where they're like, oh, you know, we have another show that has a robot in it, so we better get rid of it.
Nickelodeon for a while didn't want to touch anything with a robot in it.
Yeah, so we're like, okay, how about a cricket? No, we're a mantis. That flew for like a year or two, and then they were like, oh, we have another show with a mantis in it named Mantis. So that's kind of a deal killer. And they wanted a female character, which ended up being like one of the best parts of the show, Goat. But I mean, that whole process is just unbelievably grueling. Like, I had no idea what it was like until I got in.
And you got into it via the shorts program.
Mm-hmm.
Do they give you a lot of freedom at that point, or are you already feeling like you're in this meat grinder?
There was like. Johnny took the brunt of it because almost all the notes were story and structure and character.
Okay.
And I would just like do a drawing and send it in, and they'd be like, yeah, that's great. And then Johnny's got to go back to the drawing board for a week and a half or something. And it would go on like that for years.
It's easier to pick up the rest.
And so when it finally, I mean, let's jump ahead. I mean, there's a story to how it became a show, but let's jump ahead to you getting, you're greenlit, you have to change your life. Mm-hmm. Around making this thing, you have to play various roles in it, some kind of art direction gig, some kind of story gig.
Yeah, the whole thing was very, very thrilling. Like, right from the moment we got the phone call saying the show's greenlit, it's like, it was just surreal. You know, this thing that I've been working towards, like, you could say for 10 years, but you could also say since I was a little kid.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this was the pinnacle at that time of my career. And I remember driving to Wakefield to celebrate and be on the phone with my agent. And the final big question was, are they going to be okay with me staying here in Ottawa because of my family really situation with my ex and my children and everything. I like, leaving Ottawa was not an option for me. And luckily, you know, I talked to my agent on the phone as we were going to Wakefield, and he confirmed that they were completely fine with it and they would fly me up frequently. And that I could, you know, we'd set up this whole thing, and so it was like a gigantic celebration. It was like just unbelievably soothing and gratifying to have that, like, before any of the work started, just to be like, okay, we did it. And then, I mean, just from that moment on, everything was a first for me, because I'd never worked in animation before, so every single little thing was the first time I'd ever done it.
So how was that adjustment in terms of, like, at some point you looked around and there was a studio in LA and a studio here in Ottawa, mm-hmm. and all these hundreds of people making drawings that looked like yours.
Yeah.
That's got to be a bit of a trip.
Yeah.
Because most of us spend our careers drawing like other people.
Right.
You flipped it.
Yeah, and you know, I really dug it. There were so many people in the industry who were obviously prepared to just be like, okay, you know, tell me what I gotta do. But I really enjoyed engaging with them, getting to know them, and like drawing things out of them. Like, we're not gonna build a pack, and you don't have to, you know, mimic my style exactly. Let's, you know, feel free to like contribute, and I wanna see things that surprise me. Like, that's my biggest thing about collaborating with people, is like that I love being surprised. So mm-hmm. if it doesn't look like something I would have done, but it fits in, you know, the general sort of universe, then that's a bonus. And because of that, all my staff and I have like a really great relationship, and I think that they just get so invested, and they're willing to put so much into it because they feel like they're really contributing.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's like I was joking earlier before the cameras were rolling about when I first met you, I knew your work already. And the connection to you being in Ottawa that I had no idea at all. So I was just another dumb fan for the first 3 years of knowing you. And I think you've got a body of work out there that a lot of us, I mean, I came to you kind of mid-development, but there are people out there, like I see versions of your handwriting
right.
popping up in places. Yeah. You know, you've crept into the language mm-hmm. by making things for 30 years, by just yeah. making things.
It's very strange to
me. Yeah.
Like
yeah.
I
was used to it here in town when I went and worked at Video Mondo and yeah. I saw your signs on the wall.
Right.
I recognized your handwriting there, but to see it elsewhere.
Yeah. It pops up in places I don't expect, and it's starting to really sink in now. So I feel like I look like an old man, and I'm starting to realize that when I was a little kid, or you know, a young, like a 20-year-old, there were certain artists who'd been around for a while who, I don't know. I mean, I just feel like it's weird that I'm becoming one of those guys.
No, we're not the kids in the room anymore.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
At the border? What was the guy calling?
He said, don't worry, Santa, I'm not going to give away your secret identity. the guy in security at LAX. But he said, some people were like, that fucker. But no, he was actually being pretty sweet about it.
But it is, we're not the kids anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And some of that I really like.
Well, I was going to say that I think that my production benefited from that too, because a lot of the young designers liked the idea that I'd been around, even though I wasn't in, you know, I'd never done much in animation, they seemed to really dig getting into my work and like going back and trying to understand the way that I think. And so again, I think that it ended up helping me. Like, I don't want to say I'm mercenary about it, because it was a genuine, like I love those guys and gals, but
Well, it sounds like, I mean, for them, I'm sure it's a lot easier to start with someone you respect,
right.
you know, and go from there rather than someone to work you don't know.
Yeah, I think that a lot of them were surprised that I would come into their office and, like, talk to them and stuff. Am I being fired, you know? It's just like I just saw the crew as this, like, organism, you know? We were all just part of one.
Well, it's kind of how it's supposed to work. It doesn't right. always work that way. That's why those guys were surprised.
I mean, it was up and down. There were you know, good times, bad times, but the good times were really, really like that, and a very genuine one.
I have a question. Yeah. Since you've never done this before and you jump into Nickelodeon, would you do it again?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah. Yeah, the negative parts of it are so outweighed by the, you know, the thrilling aspect of it.
And yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm dying to do it again, but for the time being, I'm gonna do solitary things. Just to, like,
I was gonna say,
yeah.
Dude, you got two shows out there.
Well, it's not that I want to, you know, collect shows. It's that the process is so interesting and fun. And yeah, you know, it's like I do. There's certain ideas I have that are a painting. There's certain ideas I have that are a comic book. And then sometimes ideas come up that are like, this would be a great TV show.
But do you get it now? So for me, I fell into animation. I didn't plan on it really. I didn't want to work in restaurants anymore. I thought I could get a job at a cartoon animation studio. And maybe the studio itself I didn't fall in love with, but being a part of a studio, being a part of a group of people like me, that's what I fell in love with. That's why I do all the animation resources, all those things, because I love this culture.
I love it and I hate it. Yeah. Because there's still that solitary little kid who is so soothed by just being by myself, just coming up with ideas. And like, if it's a unique, real idea, if it's authentic, then I love it, even if it's not the best idea. Like, whereas in television, it's all about like coming up, like it's like chemistry, you know? Mm-hmm. Like everybody contributes and we come up with this idea that's like perfect. And in the worst scenario, it means homogenous and sane, you know? In the best scenario, it's like really surprising and spectacular.
Yeah.
But for me, it's like I love that part of it, but I also sometimes just want to get away from it and do my own thing.
Now, you weren't as involved in Bagel and Becky because you were off doing the Nickelodeon show. Are you able to make any observations between how those two shows were produced? Because you've got, like, it's part of what we're doing at Startoons. We're trying to create an opportunity for the more creator-driven things to come to the surface, the more cartoonist-driven things to come to the surface in Canada, because we tend to favor guys like you in Canada, who will walk into a broadcaster and pitch with a couple scripts and a Bible and those kinds of things.
I guess.
And I know I'm lumping you in with a lot of other. Whereas like the Nickelodeon, the Cartoon Networks of the world tend to be a little more just like they're making their money off of creator-driven shows and character-driven shows. You've got one in both places.
Well, in both situations, it was kind of like my entire career up until that point was my foot in the door. So like when Audrey from Nickelodeon contacted me, it was because she was already a fan of my comics and mm-hmm. my toys mm-hmm. and whatever. And with Michelle, it was that she loved my kids book.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like I got a little boost over that first step, you know, like we didn't really have to do much pitching or anything like that.
I want to go to you.
Let me first just, I didn't ask if you were going to do it again because I was asking if it was a terrible experience. I think I was asking like in terms of like, since you're so successful as a, like I know as a painter, did you like, you know, the animation process as much as you enjoyed the paint? You know what I mean? Like I wasn't saying like,
it's
you must have had a terrible time, but I'm just saying like,
I would do it again, like, they're just so totally different, you know? It's like they're two different parts of my personality.
But you didn't feel like your creative, you know, talking about creative-driven shows, you didn't feel like your creative vision was at all altered in TV as much as...
Not in a negative way.
Yeah.
But, going back to that whole organic thing, there were things that happened on the Nickelodeon show that I never would have expected.
And yeah.
So I kind of liked that aspect of it, and I think it was sort of unusual. Like a lot of the production people saw it as sort of like something that would slow down the pipeline, you know, like if things weren't predictable.
Yeah.
But I think what we ended up with was kind of an interesting, like it's a little messy at times, you know, which is something that animation...
I think that goes like, I don't know what the right word is, but like being the kind of creator that's open to that stuff, I think
instead of
a positive to you, you know, it's like, I'm sure you could have just as easily said, hey, this isn't exactly like what I would draw, do it again. But instead it was sort of like, let's make something new and fresh.
As an artist, I get just so excited by all these artists. Like this Nickelodeon is filled with these artists and they all have their own personality and their own styles, and generally what you do is you take them all and you say, okay, now just draw like this from now on, you know?
Yeah.
And I just wanted to, I was just, without thinking about it intellectually, I was just excited. Like, Jacob does that amazingly. Like, go for it. Do that. You know, Randall does this. Do that.
Yeah.
Like, push it.
Yeah.
As long as it doesn't look like it came from some other show, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, that's cool.
It's exciting.
Would you do... What would you do differently going back? If you got the next thing that you feel belongs, it's, I know you're saying like you got things you want to paint, you got things you want to do, your comics, you seem to be a follower, you seem to be drawing something right now that looks like a comic.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
But are you somebody who would ever, at this point now, would you come up with something you thought would be a TV show? Would you go somewhere and pitch it?
No, I think my MO would still be to
make it.
Even if it's an idea that I think is going to be a great movie or a TV show, I'm gonna develop it alone in my studio as like a children's book or a comic or whatever it is. Just because I like I said, I don't want it to be perfect. I want it to be authentic and like individual.
Yeah.
And then if you have that, then you can take it into the industry and I'm fine with tweaking and changing. But I think if I took my germ of an idea and brought it to the industry right away, I wouldn't have the strength to contain it. It would just start to like...
It kind of does its own thing,
this,
yeah.
This guy should be a girl. This, you know.
You steer the rocket, and it's once it gets going, it you know. And there's these moments in sort of development and stuff where you can feel like, it's veering, and then for whatever reason, I mean, there's all these external factors that you have to allow.
The diplomacy, so. It's like... Yeah. I can't tell that guy no, so I guess we're
and
gonna
I guess
have to
it's
go
yes.
with this from now on.
And then if you start saying no, then all of a sudden you can be labeled as difficult or combative and stuff. Mm-hmm. When a lot of times, it's not the case. It's just you know, but you feel it like it's the veering rocket. So I mean,
a lot of people would be able to do that and keep it like authentic somehow. But I just feel like for me, I don't have the I'm not combative enough or like. I just want to just do it by myself and just...
You have a unique experience. You're a guy who has made things through to completion, and that's why people come to you. You know, you have this thing where you've just been making the stuff you make forever, and your life is built around that. So that some eventually people came to you for what you do. Mm. You have a unique spin on that.
Yeah. Because well, that's a good point. Like, it's a really good point in that, like, when... someone calls Dave, they know exactly what they're looking to get. And Dave's comfortable with that because, like you say, you finish it to completion. And so you said, this is what I'm offering, this is me. And it's a pretty good match that way. I think, yeah, it's a different situation when you come with a sort of something fresh, or not, I don't want to say fresh, but just you know something that people want to mold. And I think it goes to what you said too, which is like, if you bring someone like a real core of an idea, it's going to, that idea is going to grow, and whether it grows from you or a committee or you know whatever, it's going to be a lot different. So it's just two different ways of going at the same thing.
Mm-hmm. Now, I think where I find interesting for you with you is that you occupy a similar space in that you've become part of our language too, the way Dave has in a certain way. People talk about a Mike Geiger. Yes. The next
supposedly.
Mike Geiger,
yeah.
Or find a guy. I want a Mike Geiger type.
Yeah. It's which is weird because when I developed, they say we want the next Adventure Time from you. You know, I don't know.
And so similarly, I mean, you have a body of work that has existed mostly online, shorts, web series, things like that. The idea would be that people would come to you similarly.
Yeah, and actually in both. Like, I've made a short with Nickelodeon, and that happened because they saw a short of mine at a film festival. And then more recently, I'm in development on something else where someone was familiar with the same short. But it's not like everything I do is a little bit different. So it's not like Dave, where it's like you have a very distinct style that people really gravitate to. Like, I think I just do whatever comes out, you know? And so I guess there's a bit of
you probably have more of the same style than you think.
Yeah, maybe, but I mean, but if that's the case, then there's a show on TV that I created that's my style that isn't at all my show. And so that makes it very, hard to be like, okay, so I want to create a show that's my show when my style is already being used for something else, mm-hmm. you know? And So, yeah, it's a bit of a predicament, you know. Like, I have to definitely, like, alter my style as I go so that I'm creating something unique.
So there's a lot of people that we know who get approached to do a short with Nickelodeon, and they end up going off to Nickelodeon, working there, or Cartoon Network and working there.
Yeah.
You guys, now you didn't go because you had family requirements, and it worked out okay for you. You like being on.
That didn't work out that great, but go on.
Okay. have you ever had that? I mean, why wouldn't you go to LA and find yourself in that creative utopia that some people talk about? I'm sure you must be.
I feel like it's a bit too, maybe a bit too late for me. You know, like, I don't know.
Were you ever there? Was someone ever saying, come and move to LA and work at Nickelodeon or Cartoon Network?
More recently, an opportunity's come up, but I think, like, I don't know. I have a child now too, and like it's more than just moving for a job at this point. You know, it's like my wife matters, and she has a career, and my son matters, and he has daycare and family, and so it's just not that easy anymore. But it's not to say I wouldn't do it.
Yeah.
I just feel like I've been doing this for, I don't know, you know, I've done 11 cross country moves since I started, so that I can get into the next job. You know, and wow. So. Every time I do those moves, it's been amazing. Like, I have friends all the way across Canada. It's been the best, you know. I come to the festival in Ottawa, and it's like a reunion of all my friends across Canada. It's the funnest time of the year for me, for sure. And I just lost my train of thought.
So the 11 cross Canada move. Oh, so moving to LA, a move at this point is not. Really.
No. So what I was gonna say is, like, I've worked in so many different studios, and every time you start in a new studio, you have to prove yourself, you know. And it's like, I'm just not the kind of person that goes in that's like comfortable doing status quo, you know. I want to show that I can be good at it. I have something to prove. I think, you know, maybe because I wasn't an artist my whole life, I feel like I have to prove myself maybe more. But I definitely like work hard when I go places, and so I feel like whenever I start a new studio, it's starting that process all over again, getting to know the producers, getting to know, you know, everyone in that system, so that they trust me, and then I'll go to the next one, and then they do that again. So to be honest, like, to start that process again in an American studio, which I respect, is like it just feels really heavy right now, and I don't know.
I mean, you do get to a certain point in your life. We get to a certain age, we have families, we have those kinds of things. Those things just don't become the same kinds of options they were when you were 26 and didn't have those kinds of responsibilities.
Yeah, it was awesome while it lasted.
I guess what's important kind of changes a little bit, at least a bit of that perspective shift. And I also think that, like, maybe there's that, you know, grass is greener thing. Like, obviously it seems like yeah. You know, those U.S. places are like these awesome, you know, chocolate fountains and the streets are paved with gold. But like, there's still, like, you'll still find the same challenges that you can find up here, right? Like, I don't think that, I think just, like you said, you still need to prove yourself, you still need to fight. You'll find the same types of, you know, conflict situations that you'd find in a Canadian street setting, you'd find in an American setting. I don't think it completely changes. I think there's definitely some really interesting folks that work in those places. But then again, there's just, like, super interesting folks that work up here too, right? So it's...
So what about the systems? What about the American system versus the Canadian system? Very different animals.
I mean, from what I have gathered, you know, to me, like, there's I'd see them as trains. You know, the American system, they're like, you know, we love your work, we want to work with you, we're going to put you at the head of the train, we're going to get in the back, and we're going to let you go. And if you start veering off that track, so that we feel that we have to put you back on, we're going to say, hey, you know, hey, buddy, let's get you back on track. This is just going crooked, but you're still just driving this train. The Canadian system, you know, it's the front of the train is, you know, the producer, or, you know, the second boxcar is the, you know, the second producer, you know, the third car is the creative producer, then somewhere in there is the owner of the company, and then you're the in the back. And the train goes, and I think, like, they drive the train. I mean, it's, you know, I'm not.
And if it veers funny, you get rid of the caboose.
Well, I mean, I think our voice is at the back of the train, saying, like, hey, why don't we try going?
As the creative lead, you feel like you're back.
Yeah, I mean, like, well, why don't we try going that route? You know, like, look, buddy, like,
there might be snakes over there.
Well, no, I mean, there might be snakes. You know, we've done this 30 times before. We've greenlit 5 shows, and I know how to make to the finish line, so let us drive, you know. And I think to me, that's the Canadian system, and sometimes you cross that finish line and they let the caboose go. But like, you know, I think it's just the mindset of like, well, we know how to do this, and so trust us. And I'm not saying that's necessarily a terrible thing, you know, like I don't want it to come across as like I'm shitting on the system, because we have a system where the government pays for development. It's amazing.
Chances, yeah.
You know what I mean? And I think, you know, when I first went to develop my first show with YTV, I think I needed someone to guide that train, you know, like they didn't put me in the caboose, but you know, I was back a few cars, but I think like I needed that. Like coming out of nowhere, like if I try to create a show, I didn't know what creator driven meant. You know, like I didn't know it. What am I thinking of? Like how do you make a show character driven?
Yeah, yeah. No,
I didn't even know what that meant. You know what I mean? So I definitely needed that, and I think a lot of people need that. I think it could use a little bit more investment in the creator.
Deep stuff.
So great to have someone else say this on camera.
It's amazing how different the two models are.
Yeah, and that's what we're talking about. That's what, I mean, I did a whole talk at NMFTO about this, identifying, I mean, there's a whole story of how we got here in terms of layers of bureaucracy that are layered on top, and they're all good, well-intentioned. Mm-hmm. But the end result is institutionalized mediocrity. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's what it is.
Yeah.
We're not, but you also
can't. Like, that one mediocre,
it's safe.
We're making cheese and pepperoni pizza.
The reality is no one's, Cartoon Network is built on risk, Nickelodeon's built on risk, and Disney's built on risk, because those are companies
they have
that
to. They're at each other's throat, right?
The broadcaster, they are the studio, they are the distribution machine, they are the merchandise, they are still selling bed sheets. So here, our broadcaster doesn't own the bed sheets. Yeah. Our broadcaster, and there were good reasons why all those things were built. But I'm excited that a company like Nelvana is using language right now about trying to compete with those places. Mm. They don't want to compete with our Canadian studios anymore. They don't want to compete with the Europe. They want to compete with creator-driven shows. And they're trying to figure out what creator-driven really means and what character-driven really means and all those kinds of things. Because it's language that gets thrown around like crazy for the last 10 years but at those levels, but they've never made those shows. They don't know how to do it. They seem to be taking some risks right now about getting behind creative. And that would be fascinating to see it happen.
The thing is, like in development, there's basically no risk. Like, you know, why not just let a creator go hog wild, get it wrong, and then be like, wow, that's a fucked up idea. All we got to do is tweak this and this, and we can make it work. Yeah. Rather than starting at the beginning,
panic button pretty quick, right? Like that's the second.
Yeah, you know. I think it's like.
You're using your train analogy. Like the second that you kind of bit, then it's like we've got to stop. This is getting too scary. And it's felt that way a few times. I think there's that feeling that the panic button gets hit pretty quick, without having anything to really show for it. And I think, you know, this is the U.S. places too. They invest in like, you know, animatics and things that you see, like first. Whereas here, it's a lot of like theory based, where you're doing your Bible, you're doing your script, or even just Bible before script, and not kind of. And then it feels like that's what, you know, the whole process is built around, is this Bible. Then you put stuff in that you don't really get to try out, right? So you've got like this arsenal of characters and situations and things and locations, but when you put it in a script, like when we're doing, like, actually worked out great for us on the stuff that we're working on now with the people at Boat Rocker, is that we had a toolbox, then we just like went out and like cobbled some stuff together, did a first pass on an outline. We're like, I'm not sure. And then we're like, well, let's do another one and learn from having done the first one. And then I think the second one was like, this stuff works. And then after that, you know, going back and doing other stuff, so. Yeah. Feels like that's the playtesting almost.
Do you feel like anything's changing? Do you feel like it's getting any better? Do you feel like I'll say right now, there are shows on TV right now that certainly are way better than Canadian shows 10 years ago. Yeah. We have more cartoon type shows.
Yeah, I mean, like I'm working on Three Amigonauts, you know, that's definitely one that made a turn, you know, like it's Kyle Marshall's show, and it's, you know, it helps that Kyle, you know, had a hand in that, and he's incredible, but it did feeling different, You know, and I think at this stage, you know, like Phil was saying, we're developing Dino Swords with Rad Sheep, and like there's a level of trust now for sure where Michelle's just like, you know, just do what you guys want to do, you know, and if I can help, let me know. And so, you know, I'm not saying like creating shows in Canada is a negative experience at all. I think I'm just saying like the standard quo, you know, as far as it goes is keeping it safe. And I think there is like a push to change that for sure.
Yeah, it feels like those days are over or whatever, but I mean there's a reason. There is a reason for that, I think. But obviously like having maybe if it is time for the new wave, and hopefully it works out. Because that's the thing too, like if it kinda, you know, people take chances and then they get sort of slapped in the face by taking chances, then you're less.
How much more of a failure is a crazy show than a standard show that both?
Yeah,
So
why not have 10 failures that are weird bananas? But it is. So it is. It's. I think I feel like we touch on trust, and that's what comes up all the time. So, the guys I work with start to do Counterfeit Cat.
Yeah.
And I've gotten to work with an executive producer and a creative director who I completely respect and have learned from. And I haven't learned anything in a long time, but I'm learning from these guys. And they say some very telling things in terms of the way they deal with their producers, their partners, and the broadcasters. And it's all about circling the people, because that was a show that kind of came together in a very typical development way. It was a show that was at Aardman a long time ago, and the creators not involved the same way, but there's new creators, essentially. They just love the project. And they got a director from France, and they got this other person to kind of work into it. But those became the new creators of the show, because they're the ones they went out and they said, "We want your vision on this show. We want your vision on this show." And they hired them, and then they basically just drew a line around them and they circled them and they protected them. Yeah. Now they also made there was people they trusted to deliver and not screw them in that process, so that whenever someone else came along and wanted it and said, "Why? I mean, let's make it different," they were able to say, "Look," and they did it. And this is where I said. It may not be what I do, and it may not be what you do, but we hired them, so let's trust them to do it.
Yeah, I mean, obviously it's difficult, like, you know, for a new creator to achieve trust, you know, like, clearly. I think, are you working with Frank Zaberstein on that?
I'm not working with Frank on that.
No, because Frank's one of, you know, he's so rad. He's, like, he's so cool and so easy to work with, and I think, like, Frank was one of the first people I did, you know, work with to create the shows, Frank and Swin. And it's funny because, like, when I started, there, like, clearly there's no, you know, like, Frank knows what he's doing. He's been around forever. I didn't. I'm just me. But by the end of that process, we built the trust, you know? So I think, like, as long as the producers are open to that, I think you're probably in a good spot, you know? I think. I don't know.
I mean, that's a lesson for, like, for young creators, because you mentioned that's a key. Like a young creator that goes into somewhere with a great idea, picking your producer is almost as important as what your show's about. I've created that there's, you know, the people in the world that like blue, red, green. You know, there's people like have preferences. People like certain things, and humor and artistic sensibility and all those things. Like, it's one of those, like, there is no right or wrong, but there is a right and wrong for you. And if you pair yourself up with a producer that doesn't, you know, that thinks Simpsons season, you know, 4 through 11 is stupid, that doesn't get South Park, that doesn't like, you know, like certain things that you just, you know, whatever you like and whatever you think looks cool, it'll be a painful experience, like, because you're fighting not on the basis of character or something, you're just fighting on taste. And if you're fighting on taste, then you're like,
you're constantly having to convince someone.
Well, you have to explain to someone, like, well, this is funny because, and then you, like,
death.
I call it, it's like, you know, trying to sometimes, like, Mom, this is funny because, you know, it's funny. Like, it's like, I don't get it, Philip. I don't understand. French Canadian mom is like, what's the joke? It's like, no, it's, so that, I think if you set yourself up with, like, that part, and then all of a sudden it's like you build the trust. You're talking about, like, that building that line and that circle in the sand. You just have to get that when you look at something, you go like, this is awesome, and then you should be able to show it to the people that you trust. They go like, yeah, this is what, you know, I like this, or oh, you know, you kind of missed these little bits and pieces that need some work. But generally, like, if you're like, I feel good about this. Like, it's nothing worse than being like, here you go. It's like, yeah, we don't like this. Like, what is not to like? Like,
yeah. Yeah, I think, like, I just want to add, like, for a moment there, I felt like we were just talking to each other, and I forgot this is going to go into the open. So I think, like, I feel like I just want to add, like, so working with a producer, so if you're a new creator and you have a show and you have a chance, you know, working with a producer, it is a collaborative figure. I don't want to make it sound like your vision is the only vision that counts and that's how you make a creative in a show. Like,
teamwork.
Great, creating trust is being open to changing. I think it's the sketchy part is where you change it to something you don't like. And that's where you have to learn to say, well, you know, my vision isn't that, and I'd like to keep the vision. And so being, you know, being easy to work with, being cool, being open to ideas is all part of building trust. It's all part of building a good show. Like, it's incredibly important in building a good show. It's just, you just want to keep, like, that core of your idea around if you can
do it. And a lot of it is just being able to express yourself, like, really, really clearly. So that the person isn't like, oh, you'd hate my idea. Or you're being difficult. It's more like, oh, now I understand like how that is so important to your vision.
And a big hurdle to that, like especially like in this day and age, email versus phone call versus in person versus sometimes even text message. Yeah. Like I'll talk, you know, me when I work with my sort of creative partners, like we obviously have a shorthand because we've been working together for decades, but sometimes even just like sending emails and we're just, you know, especially amongst each other, like we forget about tone and stuff. Be like, well, what do you mean? You don't fucking like this, and then you can kind of like read tone into emails, and I think a lot of times, especially while on the writing side, we're very rare we'll be in the writer's room for a little bit, be face to face, and then maybe have sometimes like the once a week call with the production team.
Sometimes,
but it's very like, so you'll feel certain things about, you know, the way that a note is worded. Sometimes you're just like, you're busy, you fire something off and you didn't word it just right. So I think that like hinders the clarity. So then if you do have a good, you know, if you're on good terms, you just get on the phone and hash it out. It's like, it's way better. Maybe it's an old school thing.
I think it's a return to what worked in the first place.
Because
we're all like, we come back to those solitary little things that we did. We're all fairly sensitive about creating things. So every time you do it, you're putting some shit out there in a
hard on the line, man.
Way.
Like, yeah.
So criticism, one way or another, is how you receive it is so much just how you feel that day and putting it out there.
Yeah.
And I could turn to you if I were in person, tell you how that something needs some work and but be very open and friendly and nurturing and love and tell you how much I love it. And but if I'm in a hurry and I write an email because I throw a note at you,
and
you
that happens all the time. Yeah. People are in a hurry. But yeah, that I think like really. Expressing your feelings and like getting right into that person's head is so important, even though like when you have to do it all the time, it starts to feel like pussyfooting.
Well, it's like when you have trusted people that you can actually just say, oh, no.
Yeah, I mean,
come on, you're doing that again?
Too, yeah.
Like, it's nice when you can get to that shorthand place.
Walking on eggshells is it can be a bit obnoxious, but you do, like, it needs to start from that, and then eventually you can be like you
just. It's fun to hear people who are not good at walking on eggshells
try to
do it all the time. It's so
shit sandwich, right?
But likewise, it's very refreshing to see someone who's like, who's just like brutally on it, like just will be honest, and you kind of like, you know, you learn to, you know, obviously eventually you learn to not be as brutally honest, but it's refreshing because sometimes you'll sit in a room and you'll watch something. And it's bad. Like there's no way of saying, like, you know, it's like being in art school again, going like everything's like, oh, I like this movie. What do you like about it? The drawings,
the colors.
Like, yeah, the colors. Like, you're just like, well, I mean, no, this is not that good. Like, like it could be better.
Greatest thing that ever happens to me is when I don't have to be diplomatic or something.
Because
I take pictures, I do all that kind of stuff. And that's my, because I wear that hat where it's development. And if everyone's and every once in a while you get something that's just really fucking good, and you're like, oh, thank God. Like I can tell you how awesome it is, and I'm not having to be gentle about it.
Right.
Yeah, so I can just tell you how great it is, and what a relief that is to me. But I don't have to now.
Oh,
have
I get
a
stressed
nice
out if it's like, oh man, is it gonna be good? Is it gonna be good? And you watch it, and you're like, oh, it's great, it's good, it's amazing, good.
So we are gonna start wrapping this up. I want to ask you guys a couple of quick questions.
Sure.
is there anybody out there that you're excited about? Are there any talented people that you've worked with recently that you think have got something that are... one quick note as an addendum to that previously, though, because we're doing this right now with Andy Greeling, who did Sonny and Bentley, our winner last time.
Cool.
And it's been really interesting to watch because we have... The guys from the UK who are working on Kind of for Cat are working with him now, and he had the option of making just another pilot. He'd essentially piloted already. That was where our prize was supposed to be. And they just said, you already have this. You already have a show that broadcasters are interested in. You already have a show that feels like a show. Our recommendation to you is we take this $25,000 budget and we do two scripts, a proper Bible, a really good animatic, and we get into it and we break it apart and we do all the real heavy character work and all that kind of stuff. And he was like, yeah, sure. He's game. Like, he's a really interesting, very cooperative collaborator. He wants to learn. He's 26. And he's going to be a showrunner in a couple of years because he's got all those pieces. You can already see it. What was the fucking point of that?
Is there anyone you're excited about?
But the other part, just the other, so, but watching them do this with him, I'm a bit of a fly on the wall with it. And they're saying, like, we're going to give you tons of notes. We are. We're going to rip this apart and give you tons of notes. None are mandatory. Okay. It's that whole thing about, like, you are the one who knows what your show is better than anybody. Mm-hmm. We're going to bring all our experience to bear and share with all this with you, but nothing's mandatory because we don't want to break your show. And he's actually gone back and he's redesigned the characters even just on his own. Listening to everything they're saying to him, he's interpreting. Like, I know they said to me early on, those characters probably need to be redesigned a little bit so they look a little bit more distinct from each other, but they never asked him to do it. He just went through this whole process of vote, and then he did it because he understood
the
lessons.
That's the perfect way for a note to work.
Yeah,
like, it'll feel authentic.
You know, you just sort of send out a nebulous concept, and then the artist doesn't feel attacked, but they think about it later, and they're like, oh, shit.
Like, I think these guys are onto something in terms of now seeing them work with Andy on this thing, that it feels like it could be that next kind of show that we're trying to make, and we keep talking about trying to make it, and it looks like it may actually be happening. Straight up question though, like, is there anybody, I mean, you just came back from working with people at Nickelodeon, I think I want to keep it, if we can, Canadian. Is there anybody that you are working with, or that you're somebody you worked with on a show, anybody you are watching, anyone you're excited about?
I don't really watch much lately.
Anybody you're excited about though?
There's some people in Montreal, there's a friend of mine I've been wanting to work with for a while. I don't know, I guess I'm just in like, development in my own head kind of mode.
Yeah, that's okay.
So I have like
not every question.
We don't know people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We don't know people. I mean, like, it sounds
you work
stupid,
with an army
but I basically
people,
am looking forward to working with myself for a while.
But is there anybody out there that you would say you're a fan of right now?
Well, you know, I'm really into the idea of making a feature one day, and for some reason, the stuff that really gets me excited is like. Kids CG features, right?
Okay.
I went to see what was that one? The Walt Dorn one. Mm-hmm. Trolls. Yeah.
And which I would never think. I'm gonna let you. Keep going.
I did not want to see that. I don't like the toys. I was like, what?
Or Justin Timberlake.
I was blown away. I loved it so much. Like, I was just fucking blown away. My daughter and I loved it.
So I'll see it now.
Yeah.
Because I wasn't planning on it.
Maybe I'm just a sucker, I don't know, but I've been enjoying a lot of movies of that caliber lately. Yeah. And
we're a Moana household right now.
Yeah. And you know, a lot of these guys I know, so I feel like, again, there's that idea that, okay, like, I know that guy, so I wonder if I could actually be doing that one day, you know?
Right.
So I feel like one of my long-term goals is to come up with a series of kids' books that will sort of be development towards a feature.
Cool.
So that's kind of one of the long-term series goals.
What about you? Any peers you're a fan of that are?
Well, they keep it in Startoons. Aaron Hong.
Yeah.
Yeah. Everything he does is.
Yeah.
Is the best. Yeah.
I mean, I'm a big fan myself.
Well, I loved his Startoon. That was my all-time favorite. Yeah.
He's still working on it.
Is he?
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah. You? Anybody? You?
I think locally. I think sometimes you're as a writer, you're kind of like locked in your little bubble with your sort of your network of peers and stuff. Obviously, everyone in my network of peers, like, I'm working with Mike on stuff. I think that Mike's awesome. I think Pete's awesome. I think Buddy Dav's awesome. I started working on a show with Joel McKenzie, who's going to be here tonight talking. So I think the people that I'm working directly with, it's like I'm blown away by their talent. And then I think. just Ottawa in general is like, because now the more that we hang out with these little social functions and stuff, yeah. I get to meet more of these like super talented people that like animators, artists, storyboard artists that all live in the city. And I'm like, yeah. Wow, you guys are, like, you're all phenomenal. Like it's so I think there's like a massive that I didn't know about this until like, you know, recently. So I'd be bad at name dropping, but there's just like this critical mass of awesome talent here in town, which kind of, you know, assume Vancouver, Toronto, mm-hmm. Montreal, but Ottawa's kind of got this like, it's like, will these people live here? Like, what's going on? Because I moved here just because my wife moved here for work, right? So I'm not like an Ottawa native, but I definitely like it here. But, and now it's like, wow, it's also good for work. Like, who would have thought? Like, I thought this was a death sentence for yeah, this is like, oh, well, I mean, I guess my career is kind of over now that I'm here. But no, it's like, there's just, you can find a way, like, I could just, you know, we could make, instead of talking about like, oh, let's go down to LA to make it, I'm like, nah, man, we could just like bring, you know, whatever that LA mentality to Ottawa. This is great. Like we've got all the creatives here that are a good group.
So all I'm going to say right now is I just want to thank you guys for doing this, because I know it's certainly Mike getting you on camera is like pulling teeth. although I've done it twice now.
Yeah.
So, no, all of you guys, really, this is amazing. This is exactly what we're trying to do with this. We're trying to share this exact kind of stuff. For your own promotional purposes, where do we find you online? Where do you want to plug?
I guess
DaveGraphics.com still work?
Yeah, I guess a good way to find a bunch of different stuff is DaveGraphics.com.
And are you on Instagram?
I have, like, there's a little section with links to various animated things I've done.
Instagram?
I'm on Instagram, Tumblr.
Okay, what about you?
MikeGeiger.com, best place for everything.
I just got words, so there's no like graphics page for Adam.
Adam on Facebook.
Yeah, I'm on Facebook.
Are you funny on Twitter?
No, I don't actually. I'm not that great with that stuff. So no, I'd say I plug my movie. So we just wrapped up our film, our first feature film, Dead Check, and that's gonna be coming out. I'm assuming in sort of rough cut, final cut mode. So it'll be coming out next year or cool. Soon. So watch out for that, and then a bunch of cool shows, Dinosaurs. Plug that. It's awesome.
Alrighty.
Can I say one more thing?
Yeah, please.
Here in Toronto. I'm going to be at TCAF. I know it's several months from now, but we're going to have a re-release of the favorite graphic novel I've ever done called Ripple. So,
sweet.
Look for me there.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, thank you again, guys. This is really a
pleasure.
Yeah, thank you, man.
And it's a lot of fun. So, I hope. Are any of you sticking around for the rest of this? You're leaving?
I'm sticking around.
You're sticking around?
Yeah,
all right,
sure.
Thank you. The rest of it. All right, we're done. Cool.